Good morning. Welcome to All Saints. We are delighted that you are here. Everything you need for worship is in your worship leaflet that you received coming in. The outside page is announcements. You can set that aside until later. And the inside is directions for worship as well as our readings. This morning we'll be using the hymnal that you just used, as well as the red Lift Every Voice and Sing. Everyone is welcome to receive communion at All Saints, and the directions for how we do that are also in the leaflet. And at this time, our children will follow Maya out to Sunday school. Yay, we're back. Let us take a moment to quiet ourselves and prepare for worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts, for as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done?" says the Lord. "Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring on it. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plan it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and your doings. The word of the Lord.
Reading from Paul's letter to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. To Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Aphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith towards the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I'm appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever. No longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to war, to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able, with 10,000, to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Gracious God, grant us always to seek the truth, come whence it may, cost what it will. Amen. O Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? The psalmist sings to us this morning a song of God's abiding presence, God's unrelenting hold upon us, God's refusal to abandon us ever, not for one instant, God's intimate and probing knowledge of us, God as hunter, God as pursuer, the hound of heaven, poet Francis Thompson named it, that searching presence that will not give up, will not let us go, will not leave us alone. Where can I go then from your spirit? The song continues. Where can I flee from your presence? God loves us, we like to say. We love God, we like to say, and sometimes we even mean it. But do we mean love like this? This intimate, invading presence, this inescapable force that knows us right down to the 3 billion base pairs of DNA in our genome swirling inside the 37 trillion cells in each of our bodies. I will thank you because I am marvelously made, the psalmist sings. My body was not hidden from you while I was being made in secret. Do we want to be known like that? Inside and out, from the moment sperm meets egg and begins to divide through till the last flicker of life shoots through the last white blood cell some 70 hours after our death. Nothing hidden. Everything. Everything known. Every speck of us known, cherished, held, demanded, owned, and invaded by the creator of the universe. O God, whose eye is on the sparrow, O God, who knows every hair on our head, O God, who will not let one lost thing go, not one lost sheep, not one lost coin, not one lost child, where are we to flee from your presence? Well, we cannot flee from God's presence, but we try to do it anyway. We lose ourselves in work or the crazy insanity of our busy, busy lives. We lose ourselves in commitments that we can never quite stay on top of. We lose ourselves in the schedules of our children's lives. We lose ourselves in loneliness and depression. We lose ourselves in numbness, falling down the rabbit hole of the internet, or the relentless drone of the television, or grabbing another beer, or giving in to another round of words with friends or some other computer distraction. Love God with all your heart and mind and soul and strength, the scripture says, and we answer, yes, yes, I want to. I'll get around to it. I don't have time right now. But I think it's because it's too hard to be known like that. It's too hard to be loved like that, the way God loves us. It's too hard to be claimed like that. Whatever God asks back from us seems like too much. Because as we just heard in that terrifying gospel lesson from Luke, the God who knows us and loves us and encompasses us, that God wants something from us in return. That God wants to be loved, loved more than our parents or siblings or children. That God wants to be desired, desired more than any of our possessions. That God wants to be trusted, trusted enough that we can willingly pick up our cross. We can even let the world nail us to that cross if necessary, because God is with us. And because we can trust that the answer to every single cross is always resurrection. The God who always loves us, who has always known us, who has always traveled with us, that God wants us to come home to a deep and abiding relationship of love, to put this one thing first every minute of every day, this love between God and every single human being. God is crazy mad in love with you, with me, with each one of us, and God is not going to rest until we give up and love God back. The writer Anne Lamott tells it like this in her book, Traveling Mercies. She was living on a houseboat in California. She was a faithful alcoholic and drug addict. She knew that she had to give up drinking and driving, so she sold her car. She was that committed to the booze. But she had at the same time started dropping into this weird little storefront church in a rundown neighborhood of San Francisco. She never stayed long in church. She couldn't bear it, but she couldn't stay away either. Because when the people stood up to sing, she said, it wore down all the boundaries and distinctions that kept me so isolated. When the music washed over her, she said, she felt bigger than myself, like I was being taken care of, tricked into coming back to life. And then things got really bad, and one night she woke to feel aware that someone was with her, hunkered down in the corner of her room, and she realized it was Jesus, and she was appalled. She thought about how her brilliant, progressive friends would mock her if she became a Christian, and she rolled over and faced the wall and said, I would rather die. And she wrote, I just felt him sitting there on his haunches in the corner of my sleeping loft, watching me with patience and love. And I squinched my eyes shut, but that didn't help because that's not what I was seeing him with. And then everywhere she went, she had the feeling a little cat was following her. And she knew what happens with little cats. You let one in, you give it a dish of milk, and it never leaves. She started slamming her houseboat door shut, trying to keep that little Jesus cat out. She went back to church again. She couldn't help it. She stayed through the sermon this time, and it was absolute crazy talk, like someone trying to convince me of the existence of extraterrestrials, she wrote. But the congregation's singing did her in. I felt like their voices or something was rocking me in its bosom, she explained, holding me like a scared kid, and I opened up to that feeling, and it washed over me. She ran out of church. She felt that little cat chasing her the whole way. She opened the door of her houseboat and hung her head. She said, screw it, I quit. She sighed and said, all right, you can come in. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Nowhere. God is like a heat-seeking missile aimed right at my heart, aimed right at your heart. We can try every kind of evasive maneuver, but there is no escaping it in the end. We might as well say, screw it, I quit. We might as well say, all right, you can come in. Our theme this year at All Saints is Love God, Love Your Neighbor, Change the World. And that theme starts with Love God. It starts with this turning, this yielding, this welcoming of God into our lives and into our love. It starts with Love God. And Love God means choosing to stop running. It means choosing to open the door. It means choosing to go ahead and fall into this crazy relationship with the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. It means choosing to let God do whatever God thinks best with us. Love God. It sounds so easy, but really it's terrifying, isn't it? But what would it take to make the leap? To try to love God? What would it take to stop running from the little Jesus cat and just give up and decide to open the door and let it in? What would it take to decide to let this love be real? Let this love take over everything we thought was important. What would it take to love God back? I don't know about you, but for me, I have to do it every single day. Every day I have to choose to say, all right, you can come in. Every day I have to let the little Jesus cat come in and arrange and rearrange all my dreams and schemes and plans and ambitions. Every day I have to stop pretending that I can live one moment without the abiding grace and love of God. But when I do, it's all worth it. Even though I'm really not very good at loving God, even though I prefer to love myself and my father and mother and spouse and children and brothers and sisters and yes, even life itself a lot more than I love God, even though I tend to love all of my possessions more than I love God, even though I don't want to pick up that cross and follow Jesus, still the little Jesus cat watches for me and waits for me. But when I do turn, when I let God in, when I open that door and say, screw it, I quit, well, then I discover that it's all worth it. When I do that, I know I'm loved beyond all measuring. When I do that, I know that I've come home. Amen.
Let us stand and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God.
Prayers of the people. O perfect love, touch our souls so we remember that loving is our exalted calling. Compel us, O God, to live simply and in harmony with your creation. Heighten our senses to feel how immersed in the earth's living layers we are. Help us to see that honeybees, trees, elephants, and all beings communicate, enjoy families, and have special purpose here, holding up especially our endangered relatives. We pray that vibrancy, health, and balance return to the circle of life. Holy Spirit, awaken us to the beings who truly reflect God's image so that we may restore our communities to havens of peace and sanctuaries of love. We pray especially for teachers, childcare providers, artists, musicians, pastors, farmers, and healers, and for all who nurture and sustain.
Yes, God.
Uphold each of us in our sacred responsibility to citizen engagement in our democracy, and stretch, O God, a canopy of divine light over the governments of the world to aid in their transformation. We pray for honest, informed, and heart-based leadership in those who hold elected office, and for an end to conflict and war, and for the release of political captives, most especially children and the innocent. Beckon us, O God, to the deep well of encounter and direct experience with you. We pray for the enlightenment of all people, for seekers and for those who have lost faith, and for those who may be too sure, and for inspired spiritual leadership around the world. Heal and comfort Nico, Sarah, Tamara, Catherine, Marty, Emily, Matthew, Dixie Lee, Karen, Gordon, Tom, Chuck, Rebecca, and all who are in distress. Protect and guide, O God, children and young adults, and receive the concerns of people here. We give thanks for an abundant harvest, the joy of discovery, and all good gifts.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may know.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. May the peace of Christ be always with you. Please greet one another.
Good morning. I'm Glenn Stashevsky, a member of the All Saints Vestry. The Vestry is the governing board of our church. So if you have any questions about All Saints, please feel free to ask me. If you're visiting with us today, please fill out a visitor card. These are found in the pew racks in front of you. Place it in the offering plate as it goes by, and we'll send you some information about our church. This is the only offering that we ask of our guests today, that you let us thank you for being with us. Right after the service, please join us for coffee and fellowship downstairs in the room directly beneath us. You can take either set of stairs or the elevator all the way down. We have three special announcements for today. The first is that the ministry fair is today. It's called Changing Lives with Time and Talent. Where is God calling you to serve? Find an answer to this question at the ministry fair today. Representatives of the many ministries at All Saints will gather to share information on ways All Saints parishioners make a difference in the world and change lives, and where you might be called to join in service. Second, Vespers returns. The 5 p.m. Vespers communion service returns today in the chapel. Come for chant, prayer, silent spaces, and communion. Finally, interfaith celebration of the International Day of Peace. This year's theme for this program is Immigration's Quagmire, and the event will be held at Central United Methodist Church, which is on 215 North Capitol Street, on Thursday, September 12th at 7 p.m. Please contact Annette Molesky if you are interested or have questions. Her contact information is in the bulletin. Thank you.
Thank you. And now it is birthday Thursday, so who has a September birthday? Come on down, September birthdays.
Smart people were born in September. Are the kids in from Sunday school? I don't want to miss any kids. We are lacking in children's birthdays here. All right, well, if they come in and they have a birthday, tell anybody's child have a September birthday that I need to wait for. Okay, we'll go. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on these your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their life. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon them this day, this year, and always. Amen. Happy birthday. And are there any September anniversaries? Oh, here comes an anniversary. I'm also taking August anniversaries that missed it. I did an August anniversary at 8 o'clock. You guys are it. How many years?
Four legally, 33.
33. Wow. That's amazing. Let us pray. Oh yeah, we're all excited. 33. Let us pray. Oh God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congratulations. And now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
we continue with the great thanksgiving printed in your leaflet. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Creator, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O God, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Thank you.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Receive who you are, become what you see, the body and blood of Christ. Thank you. post-communion prayer is on the last panel of your leaflet. Together, let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Life is short, and we do not have too much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of the one who made us and who loves us and walks the way with us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love dearly this day and always.
Amen.